We would thank you for that. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Fellas, if you'll go have a seat, except for you that are the ushers and the deacon who's going to lead the prayer. Wherever the ushers are, there's the plates. Why are we doing the offering now? While the offering is being taken and Betty is playing, this will be a time for you to think about what the Lord has been speaking into your life this week and be an encouragement to the congregation.
Scheduled to to give you a testimony this morning, a financial testimony about our giving and obedience. And as you're going to see as I go through this, that God is all about loving us, showing us what to do and when to do it. Pam and I, we grew up in Christian homes, and we talked about in Sunday school this morning how blessed we were to have that privilege of growing up in Christian homes. We were taught to tithe, and shortly after we married, we began to tithe. And at first, we tithe on our net because we didn't know any better. And we learned through Bible study and worship that we should be tithing on our gross. It tells us in Leviticus chapter 27, and for every tenth part of herd or flock, whatever passes under the rod, the tenth one shall be holy to the Lord. Thus all the tithe of the land, of the seed of the land, or the fruit of the tree is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. So as we went along, we learned that we tithed on everything, all that we had. Well, the next thing that came was teaching our children to tithe. And we started out, when they got old enough, showing them what the scripture said about tithe and starting out at 10%. And we were always scrambling around on Sunday mornings trying to get enough change for them to put in their envelopes. So after a while, I decided I would just give them their allowance and their tithe along with it. So we did it for a while, and I got away with it. Now, I understand their allowance was $1 a week, so when me pitching in the tithe, it wasn't too much of a burden. But they got wise, and they said, "Daddy, that's not 10%. So yes, I had to back up and start giving them $1.11 a week, so they could tithe on their allowance. And we laugh about it now, but it taught them something. It taught them the importance of giving to God just a portion of what He has given to them. So as time went on, we kept on tithing. We had learned that God wanted us to tithe on all that we had. And then the offerings came into play. As God grew our relationship with Him, we began to understand just how blessed we were. We tithed on all that we had, but God started to speak to us about our offerings. We were not consistent with our offerings. We were giving, but it wasn't consistently. And Malachi 3:8 says, "Will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have I robbed thee in tithes and offerings?" Well, God grew us even more. As we went along all this time, He continues to bless us, and we were thankful for it. And He grew us closer to each other as we continued to grow closer to Him. In Matthew 6:19 through 21, it says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, where the thieves do not break in or steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." So we started praying. We started asking God. We were giving our tithe and all that we had, our offerings, which much more consistent after this. But what was that compared to what we were saving? So we looked at Matthew 6:21, what I just read to y'all. It says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And God continues to grow us, but He has blessed us beyond measure. And as we think about concentrating on staying obedient to Him, as we talked about in Sunday school, consistent obedience That's two words that's really hard to tie together. But that's what God wants, is consistent obedience. So our challenge is to be good stewards of everything that God gives us. Bear with me. I'm going to read you a poem. Some of you probably heard, some of you have lived by it. But it touched my heart. And it goes right along with what we're talking about right now. It's drinking from my saucer. I've never made a fortune, and it's probably too late now. But I don't worry about that much. I'm happy anyhow. And as I go along life's way, reaping better than I sowed, I'm drinking from my saucer, because my cup is overflowing. I haven't got a lot of riches, and sometimes the going's tough. But I've got loving ones around me, and that makes me rich enough. I thank God for his blessings and mercies he's bestowed. I'm drinking from my saucer, because my cup is overflowed. I remember times when things went wrong, my faith were sometimes thin. But all at once, the dark clouds broke, and the light peeked in again. So Lord, help me not to gripe about tough roads that I've hoed, because I'm drinking from my saucer, because my cup has overflowed. God gives me strength and courage when the way goes steep and rough. I'll not ask for other blessings. I'm already blessed enough. May I never be too busy to help others bear their load. I'm drinking from my saucer, because my cup has overflowed.
Ready? Oh, shall we be? Oh.
we prepared to sing what is?
Holy, 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 page 2.
Holy, holy, holy. Oh, I think it wasn't song number 2. I think the second song is the number beside. 448, I'm sorry, 448. While we're singing 448, if the Lord has given those of you who have the gift of teaching or preaching, or if you would like to come and share a scripture passage, yes, while we're singing, this will be your opportunity to take the microphone either here or there in the back. If you can't walk that far, we understand, and we'll be prepared for you after we sing 448.